UI and UX design is a tough and complicated problem, especially so in the world of FOSS, where oftentimes the developer is also the user. This naturally leads to a bias where you are someone who is very involved in the UI and deeply understand how it works, but don't necessarily understand why it's bad. And I'm not calling out any one specific project. This happens in basically everything. GNOME, KDE, Cosmic, Cinnamon, applications completely unaffiliated with any of these desktops, all to some extent have this problem. And this is what naturally happens when we have a world of developers and a lack of designers. And here is a fun post I found. Why is that not swapping to the thing? I don't know, OBS is weird. Anyway, this is a really fun post about fun things you can do with various pieces of Linux software, which you probably don't know exist, not the software, but the features, because these features don't tend to be exposed in any of the UIs we actually use to interact with this software. Buried toggles begging to be brought to light. Transparency, expressiveness, and configurability. Throughout the countless years of research on this blog, a common thread always comes up. Some features and toggles are often hidden under mountains of hubris that nobody understands. It could be because the software is under or badly documented, that it's too flexible and made to handle cases that never materialize, or just the people don't cap what they're dealing with and never bother looking under the hood. These software are crying to have better interfaces. I'm sure we've all got personal cases that fit that bill perfectly. Let me know down below something which desperately needs some upgraded UI, but if you learn how it works in its current state, already is really functional. There are three ways to handle this these days. The mindset of keeping everything vanilla, default, all the way. This is basically the GNOME approach. The reproducible, containerized slash immutable, pristine approach, and let's rice it fun. I believe that some features and configs are often powerful and expressive and need to be exposed in other ways to reach their full potential. I'll list a few projects that I think would benefit from this. Obviously, these might have been tackled in one way or another with some obscure partial solutions, but I'll throw the hook for anyone to latch on. If anybody is bored and wants a side project to work on and is inspired by anything in this post, yeah, go and do that. Go and write code, have fun, develop. Firstly, we have font config, something which you are using, but you never interacted with on your system. Whether you're on Ubuntu, Fedora, even Arch Linux, if we go to this path right here, let's go ls that path. So let's ls inside of conf default. I didn't make any of these files. These are all things coming from fonts I installed, coming from Arch directly. But all of these are used, and you can make your own files here, all of these are used to go and edit font properties. Yet, I'm pretty sure most people aren't aware that this is possible, and there's a set of such configs pre-installed on their machines to make their fonts legible. Today, font-related interfaces are limited to displaying the list of installed fonts along with a demo of what they look like in different font sizes. That's about it. We've all seen different font viewers, whether they're in the terminal, whether they're a GUI-based thing, and that's pretty much all you get when it comes to font configuration. The Project Font Week tried to tackle this and make this more discoverable. However, it's limited and doesn't give a global view of what is actually happening. Also, it was last updated 9 years ago, so I'm sure there are a lot of things which don't work today, which might have broken over time, which, you know, as things have been deprecated, things like that. Also, it's a Java project, and, you know, we love Java. Now, of course, you can do all this stuff by hand. You can modify these files. You can learn how font config works. But if you just want to go and mess with some basic properties, there's no convenient GUI to go and do so. Audio and restore list. Audio servers, pulse audio and pipe wire are smart enough to remember the last volume used on which devices and for which audio stream, sinks and sources. So if I plug in a microphone, I change the level, and then I unplug it and re-plug it back in, it's going to remember the level I had it at before. If you connect some Bluetooth headphones, change the level, disconnect them, reconnect them, it will remember the level that they were at before. Now, the problem here is tools like Pulse Mixer, tools like Pavu Control, these only show devices that are currently connected. But that value is being stored in the audio server, and if you understand how the command line tool works, you can modify it when the device is not connected. There's no way to know in advance what volume will be used when plugging a headset or starting a video. It might blow your brain from the shockwave, or you might think there's some issue where you can't hear anything. Now, the author has tried their hand at writing a project like this in the past, PA Resto Edit. It's quite limited and doesn't work on Pipewire. And let's not forget the dreadful ulcer configurations, which probably nobody understands fully. Like many software, is an amalgam of countless smaller ones it finds on the system. I've made a script, a conf dump, to display it. However, it doesn't answer nor give a clear view of how to edit it and what happens. MIME type to application. This is basically how your system knows what application should be used to open various file types. So I click on a PNG, it should use this image view. I click on a video, it should use MPV. I click on an HTML document. Maybe you want it to be in your browser. If you're a developer, maybe you want it to be in your text editor. And common file managers such as Thunar and Nautilus have a limited scope of what they can do when it comes to associating files to programs and how MIME types are handled. What they do is mostly list the few XDG settings get default whatever, creating a new MIME type file extension, registering an application associated with a few MIMEs, or even trying to find what they're currently handling is a painful experience. I have done this in the past before for when I click on magnet links. I do not understand how it works. I copied it from somebody else and never touched it again. Now, the MIME database does have an old school editor, the MIME editor. It is a very old school screenshot on a site where the latest comment is from 2 years and 8 weeks ago. When is the latest release? How do we even do we have a latest release date? Ah, here it is. Latest release is from 2006. Now, your distro probably doesn't have a package for it, and it's probably going to be a challenge to even get it running. JournalD and SystemD services. JournalD has its flaws, but as far as binary logs go, it's fine. What most people fail to comprehend is that it is a fixed column slash fields linear storage to search into. Hence, what tends to happen is that they randomly type things until they work or memorize a single command line trick such as this right here. I have no idea how to search through the journal. I will just stumble around until I get the thing that lists out the thing that I actually want to see, and then I try to remember that or write it down and then use that every time because I'll forget it otherwise. A few software try to make this more apparent, but none makes clear and brings forward the idea of fixed fields to search into. For example, KJournalD browser from KDE, this one right here, and QJournalCTL. Furthermore, they all struggle to display user session logs versus global logs. In the systemd space, unit configuration and unit management is something that is often clunky, but not so bad on the command line. Similarly, tools such as systemd manager, which I've patched to support session and system units, are somewhat filling the gap to make it more approachable. NICE and control groups. NICE doesn't work on most Linux OSs. Basically, NICE is a way to control your scheduling priority. Yet, the issue about rewriting it is that the interaction with C groups, V1 and V2, is messy. At this point, it's like some advanced physics, where it makes sense at a localized spot, but it gets too complex when you consider a global view of what's happening. The project C group manager tries to display C groups related options in a top-like interface, but it's barely standing and working since the project is unmaintained, and it doesn't cover most use cases. Now, for the majority of people, Most people probably don't even know what a C group is, don't care what a C group is, and probably would actively make their system worse if they tried to care what C groups are. However, if you are someone who does like to tweak just every tiny little thing about your system, there is some value here. Another thing with value, which most people probably don't need to mess with, is Polkit. Policy Kit, aka Polkit, is an awesome concept in the desktop land space, having standardized actions and services that can be implemented by anyone, triggered through an indirect bus, and having a centralized policy enforcer that makes sure the caller is allowed. Basically, Polkit is the sensible way to give a GUI application root access. You shouldn't be running GUI applications through sudo. There is plenty of write-ups on exactly why, but PolicyKit basically provides a temporary access controlled, very specific way of doing so. However, the rules that Polkit has are, like many of the software we mentioned, scattered and gathered around the system. Furthermore, it's not as simple to create new actions and rules for stuff that's already present, even though some of it is in JS and lots of people know JS. I actually didn't know it was in JavaScript. That's neat. There is a project that gave it a try, PolkitExplorer/PolkitX, but it's only a rudimentary interface on top of PK Action. It's tough to search for alternatives as the results will be polluted with Polkit agents instead of explorers and managers. This is actually a semi-recent project. I am surprised. Hold up. The project is considerably older. It's just recently had some minor updates. Take back what I said. Sudo. Everyone has heard of sudo. It has even entered the everyday language of hackers around the world. Still, I've yet to meet face-to-face, I did online, someone that could explain how to configure the sudoers file and what's possible with sudoconfig. Most people know some basic things like how to let different groups run different commands or run commands without having to have any permissions, things like that. Who can explain the output of this command here or which plugins are currently installed and what they do? Let's run it. That is a lot less complex than I thought it would be. I do not understand the syntax being used for some of this though. Like, why is there an exclamation mark plus equals? I'm sure you could work it out. The sudoers file contains default global settings, aliases, variables, and matching rules to decide which user can do what and how. It would be nice to have an easier editor for it than just vsudo. Vsudo is not really a editor for it. It's like, it's a syntax checker. It is a sanity checker to make sure you don't end up with a broken config. But it doesn't really help you in configuring it. You still need to go online, read the documentation, and work it out from that. UDEV rules, basically a way to configure when a device is like plugged into your system. You're gonna use it for things like video game controllers, and I've got an Elgato Stream Deck back there, and things like that. Basically, you plug it in, it's probably gonna have some sort of UDEV rules around it. Let's just say, like most other things mentioned in this article, too many scatter comps that are joined. The only way to visualize this Turing complete spaghetti is with this command here. Similar to font config and sudo, it has matching patterns and actions perform upon match or properties to set. There is the pers tool, but it's only used to set permissions on devices. And lastly, IP tables and route management. Let's finish with a dream idea. A better interface like a GUI similar to QPW graph, that is this one right here. This is used for audio routing, sending your audio into different devices and things like that. I use it to send the audio from my capture card for my console out to my PC speakers so I can actually hear it when I'm actually running the system. We all know how painful the IP command is on Linux and how ruthless the jargon of IP table slash net filter is. In practice, this should somewhat be manageable if we can visualize the packet flow within net filter, just like we can visualize sinks and sources in the audio space along with different filters along the way. There are GUIs to make IP tables more approachable, but nothing to the extent the author is wanting here. Many software are on the opposite spectrum of the issue I talked about. They're highly discoverable and have multiple tools to configure with them, but people still find them confusing or refuse to touch them. In that category, I'd like to mention many of the free desktop projects, dbus interfaces, XDG portals, and many others. in the case of Flatpak for the free desktop world, Flatpak is very configurable, but the approach to configure it, the interfaces we have, are very much like, hey, it's the CLI, but let's put it in a GUI. It's not framing it in a way that someone who doesn't have that background knowledge, who could just do it with the CLI, is going to understand in a easy way. And this is a common problem that a lot of projects have. They're made with developers in mind and don't really consider the average everyday user who hasn't read the documentation wall to wall. This is by no means an exhaustive list of all the software out there that is powerful, and if you understand the CLI interface, if you understand the documentation, a lot can be done with it. But for those who want a graphical way to interact with things where you don't have to read every page of the documentation, there are a lot of things which have these similar problems. If you have any other good examples, do let me know down below. Frankly, I think a great example, if it didn't exist, would be the GNOME desktop. With the way they expose settings available, you'd think it is far more limited than it actually is. GNOME tweaks exist, and GNOME tweaks sort of acts as like a crutch for the settings to not improve. It's in GNOME tweaks, so everyone has GNOME tweaks installed, so let's just not add basic things like some of the wallpaper settings, which should not be part of GNOME tweaks, they should be part of GNOME. And I don't want to pick on GNOME here, but like, there is a bunch of other projects that all have these similar sort of ideas, and Cosmic has a Cosmic tweaks as well, and I'm sort of worried that it's going to go down that route, and a lot of the fun configuration is going to be, hey, you need to understand how to write the configuration files manually, and not, we're going to expose really cool settings. On the other hand, you can have the KDE issue where it exposes a lot of settings, and many of those just never get interacted with, and are kind of just there as, like, dead weight. But what do you think? Let me know your thoughts down below. If you like the video, go like the video. Go read the full post as well, because there were a couple of things I skipped out on. Yeah, go check out the original post. So, if you really like the video and you want to become one of these amazing people over here, check out my Patreon, subscribe to Libera Pay, linked in the description down below. That's going to be it for me, and bye. What is this?